Today, we're going to talk about MSDN licensing pitfalls, Microsoft development licensing pitfalls. You can create developers, I call them sandpits, playgrounds, deploy almost all Microsoft software, depending on the level of subscription, but at least Windows Server and SQL Server databases in a special place for your developers. Either you're developing for your internal needs, or you develop software to sell, to resell to your customers, to sell as a boxed product online. You can license every single developer in your team with a flavor of Visual Studio subscription with MSDN, or there's another license called MSDN Platforms. And then in that sandbox, in that piece of the infrastructure, in that development area, environment, they can deploy as much Microsoft software as they want, depending on the level of subscription. Not all products are available in all the subscriptions. And that is how the majority of companies do that. And not only development. If your internal IT wants to test the Microsoft solution, they can also do that under MSDN licenses. They can create a test platform, deploy Microsoft pieces of software, try various configurations, try running scripts, try various things, and that is all covered by MSDN license. And every user that has an MSDN license can deploy an unlimited number of instances of Microsoft software that is available through their subscription. Sounds great, doesn't it? Now let's go to the pitfalls. Something you should be aware of. MSDN is not a free meal. One of the common misconceptions is that we only need to license our developers. Say a company has 100 developers that require Visual Studio. They buy Visual Studio subscriptions for those users, 100 users, remind you. They create an environment for those 100 developers with Visual Studio. They pay for 100 Visual Studio subscriptions, Visual Studio Professional, which includes SQL Server and Windows Server, costs around $300 a year a user, to give you an estimate. So they pay $30,000 per year, and they have a huge platform for those developers to develop their applications. And these users require Visual Studio. This is all simple so far. They also have 100 users, developers, that don't require Visual Studio. And they still use this sandpit. The way many companies are thinking is that we've licensed all the Visual Studio developers. They require Visual Studio. So we created this development environment for them. Then basically all the other developers, because they don't require Visual Studio, we will also allow them to use this environment. This is the first, the most common, and the most expensive mistake, pitfall. These developers also require an MSDN subscription of sorts. If you have that 100 developers that don't require Visual Studio, but they still require using some sort of Microsoft development environment in which they deploy their products or use databases, they require some sort of a Visual Studio subscription. In this case, because they don't use Visual Studio, and say, hypothetically, for the database, they might use SQL Server Developer, which is quite free, much more forgiving than Visual Studio subscriptions. They use some sort of Windows Server infrastructure to deploy their, say, Java applications on Windows Server platform. Even on one server, all of them that access this environment require a Visual Studio license. In this case, as I said, I tried to simplify this, just Windows Server, that will be a Visual Studio Professional subscription. Now you have 200 people that require licenses for this environment. But that's not all. There are also 90 admins, IT people. And what these 90 admins do? This is a huge environment. Imagine 200 people working in a large development sandbox. This is probably a development company. This company has 90 IT admins because they manage, support this infrastructure, back it up, install the software, deploy system sensor agents. They all require MSDN licenses too. And I'm not making this up. If you download the Visual Studio licensing guide, there's an example. And there's always been an example that explains that, because installation is usage, management is usage. Even if they don't test anything there, they just touch it. You touched it, you require a license. You're not allowed in this box, you're not allowed into this sandbox unless you have a license. Even if you are the highest level of system administrator, you decided, we're going to license these machines with Microsoft developer licenses. Everybody who even touches that, there's no entry without a ticket. There's no entry without some level of Visual Studio subscription. Usually, this number of Visual Studio developers is less than a half of all the users that require a license to access that development environment. Who doesn't require user acceptance testing? If you then say to all your employees, 50,000 employees in your company, we're testing this new solution, can you please test it? Those users don't require licenses, MSDN licenses. They require other licenses to use their on-premises or cloud software, but they don't need MSDN or Visual Studio licenses. I'm not talking about professional testers. I'm talking about end users that are occasionally invited to try something. We've just deployed a new version of our internal SAP application on that platform. That is free, basically. Azure DevOps server is a production workload. If you deploy Azure DevOps server into that sandpit, that leads to all kinds of crazy stuff. The logical thinking is that Azure DevOps server used to be called Visual Studio Team's Foundation server in previous releases. You think that's a development product. It comes with an MSDN subscription, so therefore it is a development product. We use it to develop. Usage of Azure DevOps server, or previously Teams Foundation server, is considered a production use, productive use. All your Azure DevOps servers are production servers. You have a cluster that you dedicated to development with a few hosts, and whatever operating system is running the hypervisor, whatever you have in the cluster. As long as you only use it for development, this entire cluster may be licensed with developer licenses, as long as every user is covered. But you drop one Azure DevOps server on this cluster, it is considered to be production usage, not development usage, because you're not developing a solution which will run on an Azure DevOps server. Your non-production VMs don't become production on this cluster. They still continue to bear rights to be used under development licenses. But the hypervisor, if you're running Windows Server, becomes licensable as production. So if that's a large cluster deployed using Windows Server data center in 2019, you have one DevOps server there, just one VM. The physical level will require production licenses. So it cannot be covered with MSDN anymore. Developed virtual machines are not affected by this. What I suggest in this case, deploy Azure DevOps server on a production cluster. Do development, test, design in your development cluster, but keep Azure DevOps server separate. Dodgy salespeople, they will insist that you need to license everything as production in this cluster. Of course, they want to sell you more licenses. If you don't want to even get into that area when you are sold licenses like that, keep Azure DevOps server separated. Next thing, system sensor monitoring and management is a production workload. System sensor virtual machine manager may be used under MSDN licenses when you use a separate instance just to deploy and manage virtual machines in a development sandbox. That's fine. I'd rather separate production and non-production system sensor VM. The majority of customers would have system sensor configuration manager and or system sensor operation manager managing and monitoring their development environment. System sensor is an exceptional product in this regard. Such use is considered production use, but that does not change the status of the virtual machine. I use green for development licensing. This is a development virtual machine, and it has a system sensor agent deployed on it. This agent doesn't affect the status of the virtual machine. This machine may still be covered with Microsoft developer licenses. It's fine. Nothing is changing here. Don't worry about that. But the system sensor itself, just the system center itself, requires production licenses. I could be huge. Just did an exercise recently where that was a massive thing. Not many people are aware, like common sense way of thinking, we have covered everybody with Visual Studio licenses. Then everything in that environment is covered with those Visual Studio subscriptions. They think, fine, we've deployed this, we've created this, we can use system center as well. Yes, you can use it, but you must buy a production license for it. If you use System Center, and you probably will use System Center to monitor and manage development environments, that usage just for System Center requires production licenses. Thank you, and safe with knowledge of Microsoft licensing. Have a very productive week. Goodbye.